Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Inshallah, tonight what we will do is, as we are passing through the final days of Rajab, I would like to make mention of a few details pertaining to the night journey. I believe that throughout Brisbane, many Imams and orators are speaking about the night journey known as Laylatul Isra wal Mi'raj, but I would like to present a different dimension that will give us a further rich insight to the night journey. Basically, there are two sections of the Quran that highlight this night journey. Just as a reference, Surah Al-Isra, the surah that they're trying to bring on the screen, is surah number 17. It is the surah before Surah Al-Kahf. So you should remember that Surah Al-Kahf is surah number 18. And this is the surah that we recite every Friday. So the surah before it is Surah Al-Isra, surah number 17. So surah number 17, verse number 1, explicitly speaks about the night journey that we will recite and translate in a few moments. Then there is another surah in the glorious Quran, in the last part of the Quran, known as Surah An-Najm. So Surah An-Najm is surah number 53, and from verse number 13 onwards, Allah speaks about a section of that journey. So let me make this very clear now, so you can understand, so there's no confusion. The night journey is split into two sections. So the Nabi of Allah, he was invited by Allah Almighty to travel through the night. But the journey is broken up into two. So the first leg of the journey is from Makkah to Masjid al-Aqsa. And the second journey is from Masjid al-Aqsa to the heavens. So it's two legs. Now, the first leg of the journey has been spoken about in the first verse of Surah Al-Isra. And that is from Makkah to Masjid al-Aqsa. And this journey is known as Isra. And basically this word Isra is been taken from the word Asra. The second part of the journey is known as Mi'raj. So from Masjid al-Aqsa to the heavens is known as Mi'raj. And this word Mi'raj has been taken from the hadith in which the Nabi of Allah said, ثُمَّ عُرِجَ بِي عُرِجَ. Now Mi'raj means elevation, rise. So there was elevation from Masjid al-Aqsa into the heavens. The word used in the hadith is عُرِجَ بِي عُرِجَ بِي. And from this word, they have given that leg of the journey the name Mi'raj. So in total, it is known as Laylatul Isra wal Mi'raj. Laylatul Isra wal Mi'raj. Now, another point, the conveyance that Allah Almighty gave to the Nabi of Allah in Isra is known as Buraq. And the conveyance that was given to the Nabi of Allah in Mi'raj is known as Rafraf. So there were two conveyances. One is known as Buraq, that comes from the root word Barq. And Barq basically means lightning, quick. So the conveyance on which the Nabi of Allah mounted himself upon is known as Buraq. In Isra, that has been explicitly highlighted in the first verse of Surah Al-Isra. In the second part of the journey where there was ascension, known as Mi'raj, the conveyance changed from Buraq to Rafraf, and the closest translation to Rafraf in English is elevator. So it was like an elevator at a very high intense speed took the Nabi of Allah from the land into the heavens. Does it make sense? All right, now. So explicitly Allah Almighty makes mention of Isra in the Quran. In a very subtle manner, Allah Almighty speaks about Mi'raj in Surah An-Najm, Surah number 53. But not explicitly. If we want to find the intricacies of Mi'raj, the fine details of Mi'raj, we will have to turn towards the Hadith. The Hadith gives us a rich insight to how Mi'raj unfolded. Alright. Now you must have heard this before from many, many orators. But I want to present this from a different dimension. Now basically when we speak about miracles, there should be a set mindset. So the scholars have said, look, miracles are linked to prophets. Miracles are linked to prophets. So there's a miracle that Moses, peace be upon him, displayed. There's a miracle that Ibrahim displayed. There are many, many miracles that the Nabi of Allah displayed. And there are many, many miracles that other prophets displayed. So miracles, mu'jizat, are linked to prophets. And what is linked to Allah? The wonders of this world. And that's why when Allah speaks about Himself and introduces Himself, He makes mention of the wonders of this world that are visible and known to human beings. For example, أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ مِهَادًا وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادًا وَخَلَقْنَاكُمْ أَزْوَاجًا وَجَعَلْنَا نَوْمَكُمْ سُبَاتًا. Basically, the day, the night, the mountains, the sky, the earth, the oxygen, the birds, the trees, the water, these are all wonders that Allah Almighty has created. That if a sensible person was to focus and ponder upon these great makhluqat that Allah Almighty has created for the service of human beings, what will happen is it will make his connection with the Creator very, very strong. Now, what makes our connection with the Nabi very, very strong? Miracles. So people that are in a state of confusion, when a miracle is displayed or a miracle is spoken about, it addresses that confusion. So for example, the people came to the Nabi of Allah, split the moon into two. Now, of course, they were not sincere in their proposition, in their proposal. But many, many people, when they present a package to the Prophet and they say, we want to see something unusual, what happens? If they are sincere in the heart, it addresses the weakness that does not allow them to overcome into the tent of faith. For example, when we return to Surah Buruj next week, when Abdullah bin Tamim gave his life, that was a miracle. His whole life was an embodiment of miracles. 70,000 people accepted faith. True, 70,000 people accepted faith. And because of accepting faith, they were thrown into the fire. So, mu'jizat, miracles are attached to the prophets. And basically, mu'jizat address confusion if confusion is there. And if confusion is not there, it allows believers to elevate themselves to a higher podium of faith. And that's why miracles are. Now, many a times when people look at miracles, and miracles they attribute to the Prophet, they falter. They make mighty, mighty mistakes. For example, Jesus, peace be upon him, used to heal the lepers. And he used to cure the blind. Now that is a big, great miracle. But when people disconnected the miracle from Allah, and they only looked at the miracle as the miracle and the Prophet, they made a major, major mistake. They started to attribute divinity to Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him. So when a miracle is spoken about, we need to take the entire package. We need to understand the inception of that miracle is designed clinically by Allah Almighty and controlled. Then the link is the Prophet, and then we focus upon the miracle. But if we only focus upon the miracle and the one that is displaying the miracle, but we forget about the PowerPoint, we will falter. And that's why people in the past, they attributed divinity to people that used to perform unusual acts. Does it make sense? All right, keep that all in mind. Now, why did the night journey take place? It is a mighty, mighty miracle. Why did it take place? If we do have time, Brother Waqas, at 8, you're going to stop me, and then I'll ask you if you want to carry on. And if we have time, we can speak about the fine details, the complex details pertaining to this ayah. But we have to understand, why did this night journey take place? What is the wisdom, the underlying wisdom behind it? So first of all, we have to take lessons from the seerah of the Nabi of Allah to understand the backdrop of Laylatul Isra wal Mi'raj. So basically, the Nabi of Allah at the age of 40 receives prophethood. We all know that. After receiving the first revelation of Surat Iqra, the first 5 verses, Surat Muzammil, according to some scholars, Surat Nur, and Surat, any other that comes to mind? No, nothing came second. So keep in mind, Surat Fatiha. So these were the initial revelations. So Allama Jalaluddin Suyuti in Itqan, he makes mention that these were the initial revelations. Then revelation paused. Known as Fatrat al-Wahi for 3 long years, no revelation. No revelation. Then after 3 years came down, Ya Ayyuhal Muddathir, after 3 years. Now for the first 3 years, the Nabi of Allah, he took that time out to endure the mighty experience of receiving revelation. And he shared that revelation with the ones that were very close to him. But he didn't go out and invite, because the order was not there. So basically, those people that were very close to him, that he believed would take the message positively, he shared. And after 3 years, the challenge came of inviting. And from 3 years onwards, the people that were friends became foes. And the land of Arabia turned against the Nabi of Allah. Family members deserted him. So persecution started. Alright? Antagonized. The Prophet of Allah was antagonized. Those that came into the fold of Islam, they were treated identical as to what the Prophet was treated. And we know all the stories. Now this continued for 7 years. So from 3 years to 7 years. So now the Nabi of Allah is 47 years of age. He has been a prophet for 7 long years. And from 3 years onwards, he has been given da'wah. But he can't see a mighty, mighty change taking place in Arabia, especially in Mecca. People are still very, very firm, stuck to idolatry. And his own family members are deserting him. And those that come into the fold of Islam are confined and restricted by their own family members. So there are many, many challenges at different fronts. So the Nabi of Allah is not seeing success. But what happens? They hit another brick wall. The people of Arabia, Mecca, they come together and they say, look, we have proposed to the Prophet to stop this, but he is not stopping. So now what we're going to do is we're going to confine the people of faith in a valley. And the valley will be outside Mecca. Because if they are in Mecca, we cannot execute our sinister plan. And what is the sinister plan? Civil boycott. That from now onwards, we will not buy and sell, and we will not wed amongst each other. So much so that we will not even speak to each other. And we would not show any raham to each other. These were the clause that were stipulated in the contract, the civil boycott contract that was signed by the chiefs of Mecca. Now, this contract was placed in the Kaaba. It was placed in the Kaaba. And anything that was of importance used to be placed in the Kaaba. So the Nabi of Allah, the followers, and those that had sympathy towards the Nabi of Allah that were not Muslims, the family members, they were all pushed into this valley. These were very, very hard times. It was not 1 month, 2 months, 1 year, 2 years. It was 3 long years. And a time came where the Sahaba had to eat leaves, blades of grass. So they did not enjoy hot food, solid food. Whatever they could place inside, that's what they were taking. And this lasted for 3 long years. Keep this all in mind. Then we're going to jump to something else. After 3 years, Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam descended and he said, Ya Rasulullah, the mu'ahidah that they placed in the Kaaba has been eaten up by the termites, by the white ant. And the only word of the contract that is intact is Allah. So Nabi Kareem informed Abu Talib, who was not a Muslim but was confined in the belly of Abu Talib. And Abu Talib informed the people of Arabia, the people of Makkah, that you should go. Even the termites give us a very strong message that this mu'ahidah, this civil boycott is not right. And the only word remaining is Allah. So they went to the Kaaba, they found that the entire contract, the contract of dhulam, wrongdoing, has been eaten up and the only word intact is Allah. Now this started the momentum of another movement that basically was the announcement of the end of the civil boycott. So now the Muslims, they are allowed to go back. So from 3 years into Nubuwwah to 7 years persecution. From 7 years to 10 years of Nubuwwah, the highest level of persecution, and that is civil boycott. Now what happens? Now the Nabi of Allah exits the valley of Abi Talib with his followers. It's very important to understand the backdrop to Mi'raj. This is the backdrop. So now they exit. Now there were two supporters, backbone, the spine of support, other than Allah Almighty, for the Nabi of Allah were two people. One was a Muslim, one was a non-Muslim. And the non-Muslim basically was the apparent, visible veil between the non-believers and the Nabi of Allah. And his name was Abu Talib. Abu Talib had respect. He was the chief of Quraysh. Because of his presence and him supporting the Nabi of Allah, did not allow the Makkans to murder the Nabi of Allah. So he was the visible veil for the Nabi of Allah. He died. After Shaybi Abi Talib came to an end, the civil boycott, Abu Talib died. But this was not the end of the struggle of the Nabi of Allah. After a few months, Khadijatul Kubra, the Muslim supporter, died as well. The Muslim supporter died as well. And the Nabi of Allah had a very strong relationship with Khadijatul Kubra, that all his children, with the exception of Ibrahim, were born from Khadijatul Kubra. She is the mother of all the children of the Nabi of Allah, with the exception of Ibrahim. Ibrahim's mother was Maria Qibtiyah. And one day Aisha Siddiqah, who was the youngest from the wives of the Nabi of Allah, the youngest from the wives of the Nabi of Allah, she made a comment about Khadijatul Kubra that was not right, not liked by the Nabi of Allah. And the Nabi of Allah said that, you have accepted me as your husband, right? But that by the time you came in my wedlock, I had prospered. I was the leader of Madinatul Munawwara. Khadijatul Kubra came in my wedlock when I had nothing. And the entire Arab Peninsula was against me. And she was a wealthy lady and she spent everything that she had upon me and upon the propagation of Islam. Later on, Hazrat Aisha Siddiqah radiallahu ta'ala anha said that I was very, very jealous of Khadijatul Kubra. And the words that the Nabi of Allah spoke about Khadijatul Kubra, I have not heard those words for anyone else. I have not heard words for anyone else that he uttered for Khadijatul Kubra. That was the respect that the Nabi of Allah had for Khadijatul Kubra. So she passed away. Persecution. Civil boycott, first support Abu Talib, second support Khadijatul Kubra passes away. That year is known as Amul Huzn, Am means year, Huzn means sadness, the year of sadness. So now the Nabi of Allah, he looks around. That visible veil, that blockage has been taken away. Now there's an open passage for the people of Makkah to persecute the Nabi of Allah at a higher intensity. So now the Nabi of Allah looks other places. That Makkah is no longer conducive. I have been trying for the last 10 years. He is the best mu'allim. He is the best teacher. But he's not succeeding. So he looks elsewhere. He has family members in Taif. So he turns towards Taif. Now, won't go into the fine details of Taif. He arrives in Taif. And as we all know, he is abused, humiliated, persecuted at even a higher level. Now he returns back. After Taif, en route, coming back, en route, he meets the Jinnat. Laylatul Jinn. So the Nabi of Allah met the Jinnat 6 times in his life. We'll speak about that in Surah Jinn. But this was one of the first times he met the Jinnat. So basically the effort that he made to go to Taif did not go to a waste. Indeed, human beings did not accept, but Jinnat started accepting Islam. Now he comes back to Makkah al-Mukarramah. Can you feel the frustration? Can you feel and sense the frustration? Abu Talib gone, Khadija al-Kubra gone, Taif gone, Makkah gone. My followers, I can't do nothing for them, they're persecuted. So one night, the Nabi of Allah was sleeping at Hani's house. Before going to sleep, I'm going to say it in Urdu first and then I'm going to translate it. Before going to sleep, he said, Ya Allah, kaash mera bhi koi rafiq ho. Kaash koi aisa banda mere saath hota jiske saath main gham ko share karta. I wish that I had a friend. I wish I had a friend that I could share my grief with. These were the strong words of the Nabi of Allah before going to sleep. Now we're going to pause at that. We're going to pause. Now, we're going to go to another, we're going to open another window. And then we're going to enter through this door and try to understand Laylatul Isra' wal Mi'raj through the ayat. Events in the past that have been made mention in the Quran are there for a reason. So we study the stories throughout the Quran and those stories are there for ibrat, for nasiha, for advice, to draw lessons from. Now, our calendar is known as the lunar calendar. Lunar calendar consists of 12 months. What is the first month of the lunar calendar? Muharram. What is the last month of the lunar calendar? Dhul-Hijjah. Dhul-Hijjah is the last month, and it is the final month of the 3 months of Hajj. And the first month is Muharram. And Dhul-Qa'dah, Dhul-Hijjah and Muharram are three of the 4 months of Tahreem. You know, there are 4 months that are haram, that are dignified. I think we spoke about this in the past. I don't want to get into that, but I think I have spoken about it. So Dhul-Hijjah is the last month, Muharram is the first month. Now I'm going to just highlight one event to prove my point that is very, very relevant to Mi'raj. Let's study the first month. The first month is known as Muharram. Now the 10th of Muharram is a very special day. Prior to the advent of the Nabi of Allah and even after the arrival of the Nabi of Allah. Let's take one event. Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, the forefather of all existing divine religions, was thrown into the fire on the 10th of Muharram. Kulna ya narukuni bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim. So Allah Almighty directly controlled the fire without the interjection of angels. Controlled it directly. This took place on the 10th of Muharram. So the first month of the Islamic calendar gives us the lesson of sacrifice for pleasing Allah Almighty and the highest level of sacrifice. And that is giving your life.
True.
Then we go to the last month. And that is Dhul-Hijjah. And on once again on the 10th of Dhul-Hijjah, there is a story that echoes throughout the Islamic world during the month of Dhul-Hijjah, where father and son are ready to give their life to fulfill the order of Allah Almighty. Ibrahim has the knife and Ismail is under the knife. So basically, what am I saying? First month, last month. There's a strong message in the first month and the last month of sacrifice to please the command of Allah Almighty. You know what the middle month is? The middle month is the Rajab. First month, Muharram. Last month, Dhul-Hijjah. First month speaks about sacrifice, Qurbani. Last month speaks about sacrifice and Qurbani. The middle month is Rajab. So there is a subtle hint in this, that if we adorn our life with sacrifice to please Allah Almighty, Allah will grant us rise. Because the month of Rajab is the rise of humanity through the Nabi of Allah. So the Nabi of Allah was taken to a height that no person experienced before, because the height was in proportion to the sacrifice that he made that was so great. So Mi'raj, in essence, is not confined to the Nabi of Allah. Indeed, this kind of Mi'raj is restricted to him. But there are different dimensions of Mi'raj, and basically we can experience that Mi'raj if we adorn our year that basically makes our life with sacrifice. And that's why the Nabi of Allah said, As-salatu mi'rajul mu'min. Salah, the establishment of prayer, is the mi'raj of a believer. Now the only difference is, this mi'raj is a physical and a spiritual mi'raj. Physical and spiritual mi'raj. And salah is a spiritual mi'raj. Salah is a spiritual mi'raj. So the middle month is Rajab. Now Allah Almighty, when he heard these words of the Nabi of Allah, these words were the starting point of Laylatul Isra' wal Mi'raj. It was the starting point where Allah Almighty wanted to address the inner grief that the Nabi of Allah was experiencing. Does it make sense? Alright, now we're going to go to this ayat. I'm not going to go into the fine details. I'm just going to discuss this ayat so you get a good understanding of the story of Isra from the Quran. What is the first word of the ayat? Subhan. Subhan, what does Subhan basically mean? Glory be to Allah, exalted He, pure from all blemish. I'm going to give you a few more hints so you can get a better understanding. I say Allahu Akbar. What's the first word I utter after that? Subhanallah. I go into ruku, what do I say? Subhana Rabbi al-Azim. I go into sajda, what do I say? Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. So there's much more to Subhan than glory be to Him. So the academics have investigated, dissected the word Subhan, and they have come to this realization that Subhan is that being that he starts working from that station where makhluqat give up. So makhluqat, for example, I'm sick. I go to the doctor. I say, Dr. Saab, I've got this condition. And the Dr. Saab looks and he says, all right, take these tablets. I go and I take those tablets for a week. I don't recover. So now the doctor refers me to the specialist. So now I go to the specialist. The specialist gives me a few medicines. I take those medicines. I do not recover. The sickness is increasing by the day. Now the specialist says you have to go for surgery. So now I go for surgery, trying to address the ailment. I come out of the surgery and I do not recover. Then I go to the specialist and the surgeon once again. They say, we can't do anything else. Now what happens is, now a person starts praying. Now he starts praying. It's the wrong way around, but that's what he does. Now he starts praying. He says, Ya Allah, give me health. give me health. So at this moment, the one that you are invoking is Subhan, where you have acknowledged that you have no resources to address the need of the time. And you submit to the one that will take over from this point. And where do they get this definition from? They get it from the Quran. Surah Anbiya, the story of Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam. He is in the stomach of the whale. Now there is no gadget, no technology, no individual and group that can force the whale to spit out Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam. So Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam is just depicted, he's in the stomach. And that stomach is floating, it's a massive vessel floating in the ocean. The ocean is dark. Then the belly is dark. And then there's anxiety and worry and grief. Then where am I? How am I going to exit this? What does Hazrat Yunus alayhi salatu wasalam say? La ilaha illa anta subhanak. That Ya Allah, I acknowledge my helplessness. You take over. You are the only one that can free me from this problem. So Allah starts off the story of Isra with the word Subhan. And in a subtle manner, Allah is saying, don't focus upon the one that is traveling. Focus upon the one that is taking him. And he's Subhan. And nothing can make him helpless. So when a person focuses upon the first word of the story of Isra, it does not allow him to deviate. So many people say that this was a spiritual mi'raj. It was not a physical mi'raj because they are focusing upon the Nabi of Allah alone. And they are not allowing Allah to be a part of this. So straight away Allah Almighty addresses that notion and that wrong concept that may emerge in the mind and say, Subhan, that being that is beyond blemish, is exalted, and nothing can make him helpless. He is the one that took the Nabi of Allah. Does it make sense? That's why Allah starts the story of Isra from the word Isra. That from Subhan. Second, Asra. I may mention in the start, Asra means by night. So this journey took place in night. Now the scholars under this word have made mention of something. Journey by night. Now you tell me, this journey by night, did it elevate the status of the Nabi of Allah amongst other prophets? When did this take place? In the day or in the night? Allah could have invited him in the day, but he invited him in the night. And this journey of the night elevated the Nabi of Allah amongst prophets and in the court of Allah Almighty. Meaning that if we want to be elevated in the court of Allah Almighty, we need to beautify our nights. Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. We set down the Quran in the night of power, not the day of power. Night is a very special moment for believers. And those that keep their nights alive, Allah will provide light for them in their qabr. So if we switch off the lights in the night, then the lights in our qabr will be switched off. And that's why the Hajjud, the nocturnal prayer, was compulsory for the Nabi of Allah according to many, many scholars. And Rabbaniyin and friends of Allah Almighty, by practice, made it incumbent upon themselves. Not by faith, but by practice, that they never ever used to give up the establishment of the Hajjud. And that's why they used to say, and I hope you understand what I'm going to say. This is the Hajjud. This is Fajr. The Hajjud, Fajr. Ulama, Rabbaniyin, they used to pray Tahajjud Bayna Nawm, between two sleeps. They used to establish Tahajjud between two sleeps. They used to sleep, wake up, pray Tahajjud, go to sleep again, and then wake up for Fajr. That was the practice. And that's why when the Nabi of Allah used to go to sleep after Tahajjud, Hazrat Bilal used to come and wake him up and say, As-salatu khayrun minan nawm. And the Nabi of Allah used to stand up from that sleep. Tahajjud bayna nawm. That principle now we have applied to Fajr. We are praying Fajr bayna nawm. We sleep, we wake up for Fajr, and then we go to sleep.
hamara rooh hai kahan chale gaye the hajjul bain al-nawm that thing is gone long time ago istaq fajr bain al-nawm
so if we want elevation in the court of Allah almighty we need to be very very productive in the night very very productive all right
asra bi abdihi Allah
abd means slave Allah uses words for a reason when people will study the story of mi'raj isra and mi'raj together they will be blown away riveted taken back and they will focus upon the nabi of Allah But when they study this verse, they will say that despite the mighty experience and this high elevation and standing in front of Allah where no makhluk has stood before, despite all that, he is still a slave. He's a abd, he's a slave. And a slave cannot stand side by side with the creator, with the master. The master is the master, the slave is the slave. This is one dimension of this word abad. Second dimension, Allahu Akbar. One person says to his master, I'm your slave. He says, not. This is a statement that the servant is making, that I'm your slave, I'm your servant. But one fine day, the master is so happy that he says, you are truly my slave. Because of the way you have responded to my commands. For Allah to call the Nabi of Allah his slave basically gives us an insight to the obedience of the Nabi of Allah to the ahkamat of Allah Almighty. And that's why the greatest title that a person can receive from Allah Almighty is to be a servant, that you are my true servant. So a person would say that, you know, there was a dulhan, a bride. So her girlfriends all came together, they adorned her, they beautified her. Right? So she's sitting there and she looks very beautiful. And every girlfriend is passing by. You are looking so pretty, so beautiful. Every girl that is passing by is making this remark. They make this remark, we sit on the side. So after everyone sits together, the bride says to everyone, it doesn't matter what you say. You can call me pretty, you can call me ugly. But I have been adored for my husband. If my husband comes and he says, you're beautiful, I have made it. So it doesn't matter what people say. I can say that I'm the servant of Allah. It doesn't matter. I can make any statement that I want. I can say that the entire Brisbane and all the properties of Brisbane belong to me. That's fine. I can say whatever I want. But I need to prove it. Once Allah says, yes, you are my servant, that statement from that side is basically a testimony and an endorsement of what I am claiming. And that's why the Nabi of Allah said, أَحَبُّ الْأَسْمَاءِ إِلَى اللَّهِ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ وَعَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنِ The best of names are to Allah, the best of names, the dearest names to Allah Almighty are what? Abdullah, the servant of Allah, and Abdul Rahman, the servant of Ar-Rahman. These are the best names. Because in these names is the word Abd, slave of Allah. Allah wants us to be a slave. One day, an angel descended. Hazrat Jibreel was there with the Nabi of Allah. Angel descended, and the angel said to the Nabi of Allah, that I've given you a proposition. Would you like to be a prophet of Abadiyat or a prophet of Badshahat? Meaning, would you like to be a prophet as a slave, a simple prophet that is a slave and a servant of Allah? Or would you like to be a prophet that is blessed with sovereignty? Like Hazrat Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam. So Nabi Akram looked at Jibreel. And Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam said, become a prophet of Abadiyat rather than a prophet of sovereignty. A prophet who is a true slave of Allah Almighty, a true servant of Allah Almighty. And that's why the entire life announces the abdiyat of the Nabi of Allah. That he used to lie on the ground. And when he used to wake up from his sleep, there used to be an imprint of the mat on his body. His clothes were the clothes of an abd rather than a king. His choices in life, the food that he used to eat, the way he used to behave, the sitting position, the walking position, the styles of our Nabi of Allah were nothing that used to replicate the style of a king. And that's why one person came and he wanted to bow in front of the Nabi of Allah, because he came from an alien country, a foreign country, where people bowed in front of the king. And the Nabi of Allah prevented him and said, "No, no, no. Walastu bimalak. I'm not a king. Innama ana rajulun minkum. I am a normal person like you. Don't give me that respect that I do not deserve." And this is all an endorsement of the option that the Nabi of Allah selected for himself, and that is to be the Prophet of Abdiyyah. Does it make sense? Laylan. Laylan, we're going to finish this. Laylan. You see that now, lay means night. Now somebody can ask that, how long did the Nabi of Allah go for? Was it half the night, the entire night, one third of the night, 2 hours? So basically, the Quran is a miracle, and I call Isra. Allah has made mention of a miracle in a miracle. Ek heera heera ke andar. The Quran is a miracle, and Allah speaks about Isra wal Mi'raj, that is a miracle in the miracle. So the Quran is the big diamond, and Isra wal Mi'raj is a smaller diamond that is lying in the diamond of the Quran. So Allah Almighty says Laylan. Now in Arabic we call two fatha, two kasra, two dhamma as tanween, nanation. In English we call it nanation. Laylan. You see that too? Tanween, nanation is not for taqleel, for little. Wherever there is nanation, two, it gives us the understanding of something little. When Allah speaks about knowledge, He says, "Illa qaleelan." We have given you knowledge, but little. But He doesn't say qaleel. He says qaleelan, very little. Qaleel, the word means little. And then He places the narration, the tanween, that means little, little. Layl is the entire night. Allah ends layl with the narration, with the tanween. It means very little part of the night. It wasn't one third. It wasn't half. It wasn't the entire. Allah only needed a very small part of the night for the Nabi of Allah to witness what Allah desired. Does it make sense? So very little. Masjid-e-Haram. From Masjid-e-Haram. Why do we call Masjid-e-Haram Masjid-e-Haram? Why haram? Why not halal, Masjid-e-Halal? Think about it. Why not Masjid-e-Halal? Why Masjid-e-Haram? Think about it. We call the noble sanctuary, Makkatul Mukarrama, Masjid-e-Haram. It should be Masjid-e-Halal. True? So why do we call it haram?
Few of the acts are forbidden.
So there are certain actions that are forbidden in the noble sanctuary. Certain things that are halal outside the noble sanctuary become haram in the noble sanctuary. So in the early days until today, if a murderer wanted shelter, he used to place himself in the noble sanctuary. So you could not physically push him out of the noble sanctuary. So what they used to do is, they used to cut off the food line. So once he experiences high intensity of hunger and thirst, he exits the noble sanctuary, and then mashallah, people take on. So you're not allowed to hunt in the noble sanctuary because you're in the state of ihram. You're not even allowed to uproot a blade of grass, so on and so forth. Certain things become haram when the person is in the noble sanctuary. That's why they call it Masjid-e-Haram. If it wasn't for that, it would be Masjid-e-Halal, because halal is better than haram. Next one, Masjid-e-Aqsa. Why do we call Masjid-e-Aqsa Aqsa? What is Aqsa? Somebody asks, what is Aqsa? So Aqsa basically means Ab'ad. Ab'ad. Now they say, Masjid Aqsa, they haven't got the translation. It means the furthest mosque. Aqsa basically means Ab'ad, far, far away. Now Masjid Aqsa, who is it far away from?
It's like in the middle of earth.
Masjid Aqsa is far, far away from who? For the people of Hijaz. For the people of Hijaz, Makkah and Medina, Masjid Aqsa was far away. So for the people of Hijaz, Masjid al-Aqsa in the true sense is Aqsa, that means Ab'ad, far away. But that same title will not be true in its true sense for the people of Jerusalem, because it's not far from them. Does it make sense? So for the people of Jerusalem, Masjid al-Aqsa in the true sense is not Masjid al-Aqsa, because Aqsa means Ab'ad, far away. So Allah gave this mosque the title Aqsa because of the people of Hijaz, who were the first addressees of the glorious Quran. Barakna hawlahu, we blessed with its surrounding. Meaning Masjid al-Aqsa was blessed and its surroundings were blessed. Why was it blessed? Why was it blessed? Many prophets. When pious people dwell in a certain area, and not only dwell, that when they die, they are buried in that place, there's a lot of blessing. Think about it. Hazrat Ibrahim a.s., Hazrat Ismail a.s., and the mother. They come to this barren place. Biwadin ghayri dhi zar. Biwadin ghayri dhi zar. Barren place. One prophet, let's say two prophets, and a noble mother, they arrive at this place. The barakat of Hazrat Ibrahim, Ismail and Hajra was so profound that it is one of the busiest, or let me say, the busiest city in the entire world. And that's why the Nabi of Allah says that if a pious person passes a graveyard and he makes dua, everyone at a certain level is relieved from the punishment that they're experiencing. And this is one of the benefits of being buried in a Muslim country. One of the benefits. Alhamdulillah, we have a good community, but if you go to the graveyard, there's only you on the jinnat. No one there. And because it's, you know that it's only you and the jinnat, so you don't stay there for too long. You are in and a U-turn and out. There's no one there, the qabristan. And then you see all the crosses and everything, it's very daunting. But if you go to a Muslim country, I went to give salam to my Shaykh, Shaykh Musa Khan Sahib, rahimahullah, when I went to Pakistan. Without exaggeration, thousands of people, Biani Sahib ki Qabristan in Lahore, thousands of people on a normal day in the Qabristan, and everyone is making dua, some of these pious people making dua, everyone will benefit. So there's a lot of benefits in this country. But this perk, we miss out on. Because there's not many. So, we can address this. Try to go to the Qabristan. Right? Everyone should make it their practice. It was the practice of the Nabi of Allah to go. So we should make it our practice that one day we should select in a week or in 2 weeks when we go to the Qabristan. It is good for the people that are buried there that we can pray for them. And it is good for our reformation as well. Because the Qabristan allows us to disconnect from what is not true to that which is true. Does it make sense? Alright. So, لِنُرِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا. So Allah can show him the signs. The signs of Akhirah, right? And that is Jannat, Jahannam, An-Nar, seen Allah Almighty, so on and so forth. إِنَّهُ هُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. So this was the backdrop to why Mi'raj took place. Because the Nabi of Allah displayed a very high level of endeavor. And whenever a person shows endeavor, commits to sacrifice to please Allah Almighty, then Allah Almighty allows him to be elevated. And the month of Rajab that falls in between the 2 months, the first and the last, gives us that lesson. Allah Almighty allow us to experience our own mi'raj, the spiritual mi'raj. And Allah Almighty even allow us to experience a physical mi'raj in this world where we are elevated and people look at us and they say, yes, this is a person that we should be following. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك اشهد ان لا اله الا انت استغفرك واتوب اليك.